And so, God, I just pray that you might fill each heart. Each person has come here today with their own thoughts, their own things going on in their life, God, things that that only you can speak into. And so, God, I just pray that as we worship today, that our heart would be true to just that worship.
That we would lift our voice. That we would sing with joy to the God who created us. God, that we would listen intently to your word. And that we would be filled so by your spirit, Lord, that when we leave this place today, we would remember no other name. Simply that we have been in the presence of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. So bless this time. Lord, may our worship be pleasing to you. In Christ's name. Amen. Before we sing our next song, many of you know that Mitchell alternates with Natalie. Mitchell is recently married, so we're very excited for him. But he also took a job in Georgia, so he will be leading us. So our prayers are with him and Kayla as they go. But we are blessed to have Kristen Warwick, who is going to be helping us lead. And I think, as you can see, she does a phenomenal job. And honestly, I can't say enough. I am so thankful for the grace God gives me through Daphne, through Chris, and through Kristen. It really does make this a joy. So y'all keep praying your prayers and introduce yourself after the service. But for now, let's stand and sing.
In the darkness, my God, that is who. Cruising by. Once and for all.
Today we will be reading Colossians chapter 3, verses 2 and 3. And it reads, set your mind on things that are above, not on things that are on earth. For you have died, and your life is hidden with Christ in God. Our second scripture will be Romans chapter 14, verses 7 through 9. And it reads, for none of us live to himself, and none of us dies to himself. For if we live, we live to the Lord. And if we die, we die to the Lord. So then, whether we live or whether we die, we are the Lord's. For to this, in Christ died and lived again, that he might be the Lord, both of the dead and of the living.
All right, for those of you, at least some of you know who that is Gar. Gar had been helping us with worship for a while. He went into the Army Reserves, and he has since completed basic training. Is at AIT. Hopefully he will be home November 4th. So keep him in your prayers. When he gets back, I think he's going to go visit his family in Florida. He'll be back in December. All right. So before we get started, let's pray and ask for God's help. Gracious and almighty God, Lord, we are just thankful for, again, this day and this time. God, we come before you and we acknowledge our need of your Spirit. Father, that you would take my feeble attempt to prepare, that you would make this whole. Any place that I fall short, God, that you would lift up. Lord, I just pray that you would get me out of the way. And again, when all has been said, that the only thing that we might remember is being in the presence of Christ. Show us ourselves within your word. Show us our Savior. Christ's name. Amen. All right. So a few weeks ago, we started this short series called Fear and Faith. We sort of kicked things off a couple weeks ago by taking a look at what the Bible has to say about fear itself. How does it define fear? What are the different ways it talks about fear? And we talked about this passion that we all have inside of us, right? This natural desire to want to live life that's more about, right, fulfillment than it is achievement, right? But what fear ultimately wants to do, right, it wants to press in and narrow, right, the boundaries in which we live, right? And that's what it does. It tries to keep us where we are, right, to hold us back. Fear tries to limit our experience in life, right? It convinces us that risk is, it's too risky. Fear skews our perception. It erodes trust. It robs joy from our lives. It tries to convince us that we're weak. We're not capable. Right? We can't do whatever it is. But I always like the lyrics of the song saying, like, "Fear is a liar." That's what it is. Right? And God never intended us to live in that, to walk in that, to allow that to keep us from living our lives both fully and passionately. All right, so we moved from that last week into a shift from fear and anxiety itself to another type of fear. One that impacts, I think I would dare to say, one that impacts our life probably more so than just about anything else. Probably more so than maybe some of us would even be willing to admit. And maybe for some of you in here, this possibly has even dominated much of your life. It is often the source of the insecurities that we have, and it only leads to an increase in stress and anxiety. I struggle with it. We all struggle with it. And it's something that the Bible takes very seriously. I think saying this that we're talking about today as much, if not more than anything else, right, hinders or kills our faith. And ultimately, what we're talking about today is the fear of man. The fear of man. So, we're going to finish what we started last week. Hopefully, we're going to tie all this together. It won't take me as long this week as it did last week. I say that for your encouragement. But I want to tie all this together before we move on to next week and start talking about the fear of the Lord. And I hope you'll come back because I'm excited. It's one of my favorite stories in Scripture in 2 Chronicles of a guy named Uzziah. All right, so last week in Galatians 1, right, we talked all about right, what Paul was trying to address. There were these people who started to preach another gospel, right? And so here was Paul, here was the question that Paul asked in response to that. This was in Galatians 1:10. He said, "For am I now seeking the approval of man or of God? Or am I trying to please man?" Right? So, seeking the approval of man, if we say this another way, right, the fear of the disapproval of others. I mean, that's what the Bible calls the fear of man, or the fear of people. Right? Think of it like, maybe, I think if we think peer pressure, that gives us an idea. Right? Now, if I say that, I think it would be natural for most of us to think, when I say peer pressure, right, we often think about that in the context of a teenager. Right? And that, I mean, that's true. I think that peer pressure can be very difficult for teenagers. I mean, it wasn't that long ago I was a teenager. I don't want to do math, but I kind of remember some of that, you know, maybe 10 years ago, 12, 15, I don't know. Anyway, but the pressure can be very difficult for teenagers, right? They very often have this extreme fear of being rejected, right? And so what do? They become very skilled at saying or doing things or looking a certain way, right, in order to gain some type of acceptance or approval by their peers. Right, you guys know what I'm talking about. Right? Some people struggle with that more so with others, but we see that very much so in the life of just about every teenager. Right? There's this idea that, right, to be known, to be fully known, right, like if people really saw who we are, man, that wouldn't get it. That wouldn't cut it. Right? People wouldn't accept us if they really saw who we are. It wouldn't be good enough. And so again, they try really hard. Right? This especially can be the case when you don't have a solid, family home, which a lot of people don't, right? You don't have an example of this is what it means to be a mom, a godly wife, or a man, a godly husband. It can cause a lot of identity issues, right? And so they will start to try to, take on some of the actions that they see other people do, the patterns of behavior, so they can feel like they fit in. Peer pressure. But that's not just a teen issue, right? I mean, come on. I don't think that we just somehow grow out of that, when we become an adult, right? I don't. And so I'll ask, you don't have to answer, maybe, you think about this in your own mind, right? How many of you have a fear of failure? Right, so I wasn't doing that in trial. I was like, is that fear really about failing? Or is it more about what people will think of you if you actually fail? How about do you get embarrassed easily? Right? Like sometimes, like you're the type of person when it happens, like everybody knows because your face is as red as, everybody's like, oh my gosh, you start sweating. So do you get embarrassed easily? Like if I just, if I call out somebody's name right now in the service, right, I came up here and I grabbed his microphone and I said, all right, so-and-so, come here. I want you to stand up and tell me, right, how this has affected your life and what your experiences are, right? I'm not going to do that. But it's so funny because you watch people like, oh my gosh, is he going to come over here and hand me his microphone? But right, I mean, we start to get nervous. Why? Right, because we have a fear of man. Of what people might think of us. I think about public speaking, right? That's like one of the biggest fears. I remember the first time that I ever preached, it was on a Sunday afternoon. Webb Belanger was the pastor here. They had the, I can't even think of it, what's the, when they have all the services that come together.
Lenten.
Lenten services, right? All these churches come together in the afternoon. He called me at like 1 o'clock. He was like, hey, would you be able to preach for me this afternoon? I could hear inside my head, I was like, God, no, I'm not doing that, right? But that's what I felt like God was leading me into, and you know, so I felt like at the same time I couldn't say no, so I said, well, okay, yeah. And I remember when I got there, right, and I literally kind of wrote everything out in a couple hours. I didn't even know exactly if it was coherent or what. I remember getting there, man, it was full of people. And I remember I kept having to do this. I was so nervous. I felt like my lips were going to stick together and I wasn't going to be able to talk. I was just, you know what I'm saying? So, but, you know, the reason I felt that way is because I feared what other people might think, right? What if the message was bad, right? I mean, what if it just stunk, right? For those of you who were last week, you can go ahead and laugh. Like the joke I tried to tell last week, it just fell flat, right? But you say that, right? What if your whole message is like that? Right? That's fear of man. But it makes us do all sorts of crazy things, right? Think about it. I mean, do you know somebody, right, who embellishes stories, right? When you share a story or some sort of, whatever, you're just talking with somebody, right? Do you find yourself, like, weaving into these little white lies, right, to, you know, I don't know, maybe feel like you're trying to make somebody laugh or make it sound better? How often do you leave things out about yourself when other people are asking about you? How often do you find yourself overcommitted because you're just, I mean, you're afraid what somebody will think of you if you say, no, I can't do that. What about this one? This is a big one, right? Especially for us. What about evangelism? Have you ever not shared your faith in Christ because you're just fearful of what somebody else might think? Right? They might call you, you know, Jesus freak, you really believe that mess? I mean, how often do you not share it because, I mean, that's fear of man. Fear of what others might think. And the fear of man, right, Proverbs 25, lays a snare. It's a trap, okay? It's something that we're all enticed by, right? But it'll never give us what we're looking for, right? We see that thing in there, like, oh man, get some of that, next thing you know, bam, it grabs us. It'll never give us what we're looking for. Let's see if we really sort of strip this down, right? Try to remove all the clutter around this issue, right? We're gonna find that the whole problem, I think, is simply this. Ultimately, what it comes down to is that we fear people more than we fear God. We hold people in awe more than we hold God in awe. We give more weight to their opinions and their approval than we do God's. I mean, that's the crux of it. Now, in that thought, I came across, I wanted to share just a little, you know, clip of an article that was written by John Bloom. He's an author, a writer from Desiring God, which is where John Piper, you know, has all created all that. But he makes a really important point in all this. And listen to what he says. He says, we cut through to the heart of things if we remember a simple biblical truth. Listen now. We obey the one we fear. That's pretty strong. The person or persons whose reward of approval we desire most, whose curse of disapproval we most fear to receive, is the person that we will most likely obey. And listen now, for everybody in here, all of us, right, somebody's approval really matters to us. You can probably think about who that person is. All of us, every one of us has somebody that in the end, right, what we want to hear them say is, well done. Awesome. Man, I just so glad that I know you. So, you know, proud of you. Well, I mean, whatever. We all have that person that we just long to hear them say something, right, that to affirm, right, this gnawing feeling that we have inside of us. Now, I don't want you to think that what I'm saying here is that we should just live, right, with total disregard. Like, I don't care what anybody thinks. Like, I want to be that guy, right? Marcus didn't care what anybody thinks. Sometimes I have to be careful of that. I do care, but you know, I'm not saying that we should just totally live with disregard for what other people think, but I think that the weight should ultimately be placed on God's glory instead of people's approval. All right? Now, I want to talk about that for a second. All right? The word glory. Right? So what I said was, the weight should be ultimately placed on God's glory instead of people's approval. See, the Hebrew word for glory has the root meaning of weight, right? Or heaviness. Have I heard that, right? The weight of God's glory. So when you give glory to something, you give weight to it. Okay? So in essence, right, when you choose the approval of people over pleasing God, right, we give glory to people because of the weight that we place on what they think. All right? Come on now. What? We take the weight that belongs to God and the glory, right, that belongs to God, and we give it to people. And so, again, I want to make sure I'm clear on this. Again, I'm not saying that we as Christians shouldn't care about what other people think of us. Right? But too often, other people's opinions have taken way too much weight. Or we have placed way too much weight on them. And see, that's why Paul's message last week about the gospel was so important. I mean, that's why I wanted to spend so much time that I did last week, right, talking about it. Because understanding and believing the gospel, right, not some of the gospel that he mentioned, is so important, like, for us to get that. Like, what is the gospel? Understand it. Right? Because when you understand how much God loves you, right, not some future version of who you are, right? Somebody who's, right, conformed their life to this good external behavior, but is absolutely dead and miserable inside, right? So it's not about some future version of you, but you now. Right? Then you begin to see, right, just how complete you have been made in Christ. Right? That's when grace begins to shape your life. How you see, how you speak, how you live. See, that's why the fear of man is a trap. Right? Because it causes you to give value to things that were never meant to have the kind of value that we place on them. Man, that absolutely points us back to our first message. Now, I would just encourage you, if you have not listened to that, go back and listen to it. Because it points us right back to the very first message that we talked about, all with fear and anxiety. You remember, right, we talked about this, right, this idea of value or worth, right? And Jesus sort of wove that into his whole talk about fear and anxiety, right, that we experience. For example, he said, don't be anxious about your life, what you'll eat, what you'll drink, right? And then remember, he asked this question, is life not more than food and the body more than clothing? Right? You remember he said, are not two sparrows sold for a penny? It's kind of weird. Like, why are we talking about that? You know, in the place of fear. Aren't you worth more than many sparrows? So in the context of fear and anxiety, Jesus says, be careful where and how much value you place on the things in your life. Because the more value that we give things in our life, the more weight we place on them, the more fear and anxiety seems to exist around those things in our life. I mean, we hold on tighter to certain things, and the more value we give them, and then what happens is the more we begin to fear what life would be like, right, if we lost whatever that is. So again, the fear of man, the fear of people, is a trap because it causes us to place way too much value on the wrong things. It causes us, we seek things out that in the end cannot ultimately help us. it causes us to seek the approval of people, which in the end, right, doesn't matter, instead of seeking the approval and glory of God, which absolutely does matter. The fear of people is a trap because it leads us to making decisions that we really don't want to make. We don't want to make them, and we get caught up in this, you know, this seems like a continuous pattern of worrying about what other people are going to think if we don't do whatever it is. And so when you think about that in the context of the church, holy cow, we can talk about that all kinds of stuff. And we give way to all kinds of things, right? And in our life personally. So what's the answer, okay? I mean, right, so we established this fact that the fear of man is, right, it's a trap, okay? So what's the answer? How do we deal with it? Right, well, I think I said this already. It starts by understanding and believing the gospel. And so here's how we're going to tie all this together. Hopefully, you know, God, through His Spirit, will allow you to take hold of this as we finish up. So as you leave here, right, this is what I would ask you to take with you and just think about this week, pray about this week. So every other Friday night, we have a sort of a guy's night at my house, right? And so we're now from elementary age all the way up to full grown age, right? And so we come over, we hang out. You know, we might play a little bit of basketball or football or something like that, whatever. We have a meal, nothing fancy, and then we'll sit outside in the backyard around my burn barrel and just have this real short discussion. All right, now a few weeks ago, we talked briefly about the gospel, right? We were sitting around, so I'm just talking about the gospel. And I think I just kind of wanted to ask you sort of the same question I put before them 2 weeks ago, right? Now follow along with me now, I need you to pay attention. Now, Matthew 3, right, when Jesus is being baptized, everybody with me, everybody knows when Jesus is being baptized, okay? Things opened up, and all of a sudden this voice came down from heaven, right? And what it said was, Jesus, you are my son, whom I love, and in whom I am well pleased. It's this awesome picture, right? Jesus is about to begin his earthly ministry. But you ever wonder why Jesus was being baptized? I mean, why was he being baptized? You ever thought about that? I mean, why was he baptized? I mean, sinners get baptized, right? I mean, but Jesus wasn't a sinner. He was sinless. So what's up with that? What was the baptism for? Right? Or who was the baptism for? Can you tell them? You remember? He didn't want to say. Ryan said it. It just absolutely hit me right in the heart. Ryan said it was for us. Yes, it was for us. It was for you, and it was for me, right? Because after that, he goes on to live the life that we couldn't live, right? He dies the death that we deserve. And what God says to Jesus in his baptism, he says to us through Jesus' baptism, listen, you are my son, you are my daughter, in whom I am well pleased. There is never a day that I regret opening your heart and filling you with my Spirit. I don't regret saving you at all. So we have our scripture from Colossians. We're almost done. Colossians 3. You don't have this right. Hopefully you got your Bibles with you anyway. If you have been raised with Christ, seek the things that are above where Christ is, seated at the right hand of God. Set your mind on the things that are above, not on the things that are of the earth. All right, listen, verse 3. For you have died, and your life is hidden with Christ in God. See, when your life, when your identity is hidden in Christ, right? It's not hidden from everybody else, right? But it's just protected by Christ. Your identity is in Christ, and you are totally filled with love and approval and affirmation that no person could ever give us. No thing on this earth will ever fill. To say one of my favorite quotes by John Owen, "Oh, to behold the glory of Christ. Herein would I live, herein would I die, herein would I dwell in my thoughts and affections, until all things below become unto me a dead and deformed thing, no longer suitable for my affections or embrace." Oh, that we could press into that and live such a life that those things no longer had our affections, right? That they didn't rob us of our joy. And so the gospel is what this is all about. We don't, at the end of the day, we choose Christ, right? We love people, right? But we don't exalt them to a place that only Christ can be. And so the gospel is realizing, right, that we are more sinful and flawed in ourselves than we ever dare to believe, yet at the same time, that we are more loved and accepted in Jesus Christ than we could have ever even begun to imagine. Don't let the fear of people rob you from life that God intended to live, because there is so much more out there I don't want to miss and I don't want you to miss. Let's pray. God, thank you so much. I don't know what else to say other than what I have said. I just pray that you would just add your blessing to this word today. God, we're about to sing, stand and lift our voice to you. I just pray that you just fill our hearts with joy. Let us know that we are in, that you are in our presence. And I'm just so thankful for every person in this room. Lord, bless them as we leave here today. Lord, that they might flourish and become more than the men and women that you've created them to be. In Christ's name, amen. All right, y'all ready to sing?